Hello everyone, and welcome to this lecture about vibrations in shafts. In this lecture I will derive the equation of motion for torsional vibrations in shafts. I've sketched here a shaft with a fixed left-hand side and a free right-hand side, and I will assume here that the cross-section is circular. So let me start off by writing down a couple of properties. First, some geometrical properties. The length of the shaft is L, so we do it as follows, that x is 0 here and x is L over here. The radius of the cross section, I will denote that by capital R. Furthermore, I need the material properties, the material density, which is rho, and for torsion we need the shear modulus, which is capital G. Now, for describing the displacement field of the shaft, I'm going to use the angle of twist, which is denoted by the Greek symbol phi, and it depends on x and t. So at each location, there is a cross section. This cross section will rotate, it will twist, and this can be different at for every cross section, and it may vary in time as well. And the positive direction for twist is like so. Now, before we actually come to the equation of motion, we need to recap some relations that were done in mechanics of materials between the angle of twist and the shear strain and shear stress inside the circular shaft. So for that I'm going to need a couple of figures. First of all, a top view. So I'm going to look at this. This is the top view of the shaft, where this is cross section at location x, and over here we have a cross section at location x plus dx. All right, and I also need the side view. So this is the side view. Let's have a look at a material point that was originally here, and that because there is an angle of twist, it will move to here. All right, such that this angle, that is phi at location x at time t. Now, the displacement all along the outer circumference, the outer surface of the shaft, is simply r times phi at x comma t. All right, so with that, let's now go to the top view. Let's look at a segment that was originally here and straight. So in the undeformed configuration, this is a straight segment. Now at location x, we have a certain angle of twist phi at x, and as a result, after deformation, it will this will be here. Let me close this, such that this displacement is r times the phi at x comma t. However, at x plus dx, phi can be slightly different, and therefore this point is maybe displaced all the way to here. So this is r times phi of x plus dx comma t. Okay, so that means that this fiber, after the deformation, in the deformed state, is not straight, but it is under some angle. And this angle is called the angle of shear gamma. Okay, now let's do a couple of things here. So this gamma is actually the shear strain, right? So first of all, I'm going to need a Taylor series that expresses phi at x plus dx in phi at x comma t plus its derivative, so d phi dx at x comma t times dx plus higher order terms. Okay, then for gamma, if we consider only small shear strains, small strains, we can find that this angle in this way, gamma, also depends on x and t, all right? And that in fact, this gamma equals this, the tangent of gamma is this distance divided by this distance. Now, for small angles, the tangent of some angle is the angle itself. So this would be r times phi at x plus dx, comma t, divided by, oh no, sorry, so this is the displacement as a whole, but we only need this distance, oh, sorry. We only need this distance, so we need to subtract r times phi at x, comma t, and we should divide this by dx. So that is just the derivative d phi dx at x comma t multiplied by r, right? Because we subtract r times phi from r times phi plus d phi dx dx. So this is gamma at the outer surface. Now we can also construct a relation for gamma somewhere inside the material. So suppose that we are not looking at how a fiber at the outer surface deforms, but maybe how this fiber deforms. So clearly, this fiber, let's say at a location r in the cross section, is not is less than capital R. So what we could do, we can modify this such that gamma becomes a function of x, r, and t, and this is then simply small r times d phi dx, where phi depends on x and t. Okay, so this is the expression for the shear strain in the material at cross-section x and then inside the cross-section at radial distance r. Okay, now the shear stress tau, which will also depend on x, r, and t, is simply g times gamma, where g is this shear modulus, all right? So this is r times g times d phi dx of x and t. Okay, so now we also have this expression for the shear stress, which is good that we are going to need, because the most important thing is that we see that this shear stress depends on R linearly. So that means that if we make a sketch of the cross section and indicate the shear stress along a radial line, we will see that it is zero in the center and maximum at the outer circumference. So this will typically be the the distribution of tau in a cross section. Okay, so tau is not constant, it varies linearly. Then what is also important is the relation between tau and the equivalent torsion moment. So tau varies like this in the cross section. As a result, there will be a torsion moment. Let me sketch that again. A torsion moment, T, okay, that is the static equivalent internal load. So this T, which varies with x and t, is equal to the integral over a cross section of r times tau dA. So basically it means that at a location r, there is a little surface. At this surface dA, we have a stress tau, all right? The contribution of this infinitesimally force tau times dA to the moment balance is r times tau. And we integrate over the entire cross-sectional area. So if we substitute the relation for tau here, we take outside of brackets terms that do not depend on r, on the location of the cross section, we get a g times this integral over the cross section of r squared dA times dy dx, which still depends on x and t. Now, this integral that we see here, that is actually, it's a property of the area. We call it the torsion constant. The torsion constant. And that is denoted by J. And we define it as the area integral of r squared dA. And for this case, for circular cross-sections, it is actually equal to the polar moment of inertia. It is sometimes referred to it as that, but I will just simply call it the torsion constant. So with this, we obtain that the relation between t and the derivative of the angle of twist is gj times dy dx. Okay, and this is an important relation, the relation between internal load and the function that describes the displacement field. Okay, so at this point, this is something you might remember from mechanics of materials, but in any case, we have it now. At this point, we can turn our attention to making a free body diagram of an internal piece of shaft. So let's do it like this, where this is at location x, this is at location x plus dx. We might have some internal torsion. So this is t at x plus dx, comma t. This is t. Oh, this is not so smart to put it here. This is t at x, comma t. And there can also be some distributed moment. Oh, I should use double arrowheads. Distributed moment that I will call m of x and t. So that is basically a moment per unit length. So if I now do the moment balance, the sum of the moments about the x-axis, where I take in this direction to be positive, this is equal to the second moment of mass of this body about the center line. So this is going to be rho times I times dx times, and now we should have the second derivative of the angle of twist, the angular acceleration. So that is d squared phi, let me do it like this, dt squared. All right, and this equals all the moments. So we have this torsion moment on the right-hand side. I will develop its Taylor series immediately. So we have t at x, comma t plus dt dx dx like this, minus t on the left plus m of x and t times dx, like so. So what we see is that these t's cancel and that the remaining terms all have a dx in it. So it's like this. I take everything to the left-hand side and obtain rho I times the second time derivative of phi minus dt dx is equal to m. And now if I substitute this relation between t and phi, I finally obtain the equation of motion of torsional vibrations in shafts as rho times I times the second time derivative of phi minus gj times the second spatial derivative of phi. And this is equal to m. So this is the final equation of motion. Great. So what I would like to emphasize here is that the final form of the equation of motion is exactly the same form as the equation of motion of a vibrating string and of vibrating bars. And of bars. Again, this is a wave equation where we see a second time derivative, a second spatial derivative. So all the mathematics that comes next in doing equilibrium analysis, in determining natural frequencies and modes, in free and forced vibrations, is actually mathematical identical to what we have seen before. So of course the physics is different. This is torsion of shafts and not transverse vibrations of strings or longitudinal vibrations of bars, but all the math we need is exactly the same. So I think for this reason it doesn't make a lot of sense to go through all these separate steps in future video lectures, because I think that once you see you end up with this equation of motion, you must recognize that it's the same form as what we have done before. So if you encounter problems in the torsional vibrations of shafts, you can just copy-paste all the techniques we have discussed before. So in fact, the only thing that is different, I would say, is the physics of getting to this equation of motion. And I hope by this lecture, this is more or less clear to you. So I will not go through all the other steps, and I will immediately conclude this vibration of shaft lecture here. I hope you can appreciate the fact that the mathematical form is the same. And I would like to thank you very much for watching and see you in the next video.